welcome to worship here at First United Methodist Church of Waxahachie, Texas. We're so glad to have everyone gathered here in the sanctuary, and we welcome all of our friends who have gathered with us online. It's another special Advent Sunday. You can see the lights on the tree and the beautiful Advent decorations that are all just so gorgeous in this season. It's a special day. Our Flame Worship Arts students will be helping lead this service. Our choir will be singing with them. It's going to be a great service. I'm so glad you're all here. We are also busy during this season preparing for Christmas and for what will be to come. But I think one of the most important things for us to do is to slow down, to stop, to be still and listen for God. And the most important way we do that is in worship. To listen for God's voice in the beautiful music, in the scripture, in the sermon that Dr. Tully will bring to us today. And so now, let us prepare our hearts and minds for a beautiful service on this Advent Sunday.
Sing we now of Christmas, Noel, sing we here. Hear our grateful praises to the babe so dear. Sing we Noel, the King is born, Noel. Sing we now of Christmas, sing we now, Noel. Angels call to shepherds, leave your flocks at rest. Journey forth to Bethlehem, find the child so blessed. Sing we Noel, the King is born, Noel. Sing we now of Christmas, sing we now, Noel. In Bethlehem they found him, Joseph and Mary mild, seated watching the Holy Child. Sing we Noel, the King is born Noel. Sing we now of Christmas, sing we now Noel. From the eastern country came the kings afar, bearing gifts to Bethlehem, guided by a star. Sing we Noel, the King is born Noel. Sing we now of Christmas, sing we now Noel. Gold and myrrh they took their gifts of greatest price. There was ne'er a stable so like paradise. Sing we Noel, the King is born Noel. Sing we now of Christmas, sing we now Noel.
And now our Flame Worship Arts kids will lead us in the Advent candle liturgy. Let us prepare for lighting the Advent candles.
Longing for light, we wait in darkness. Longing for truth, we turn to you. Make us your own, your holy people, light for the world to see. Christ, be our light, shine in our hearts, shine through
last week we lit the candle of hope. We lit it again as we wait in expectation that even now God is with us, working to restore the fullness of life with God and one another.
When the angel Gabriel visited Mary, announcing God's plans for her to conceive and give birth to the Messiah, Mary said to the angel, "How can this be?" And yet, only a few months later, Mary sings to Elizabeth, "My soul glorifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior, for he has been mindful of the humble state of his servant. From now on, all generations will call me blessed, for their mighty one has done great things for me. Holy is his name."
We, like Mary, hear God's call to be part of making God's dream for our salvation and flourish through the reality. God's love transforms us into bearers of good news.
Today we light the candle of love to symbolize the love that changes us.
May love grow within us, transforming us into bold witnesses of God's
truth, our voices and our lives.
Amen.
Christ be our light, shine in our hearts, shine through the darkness. Christ be our light, shine in your church, gather today.
Let us pray. Good and gracious God, we give you thanks for the good gifts of life. for gifts of love and joy during this Advent season, for gifts of comfort, even those we do not see, even when we do not feel the joy of this season, for gifts of healing and mercy, for gifts of patience and peace, for gifts of hope as we prepare our hearts for Christ's coming. Christ's presence changes our world. So we pray that Jesus may indeed be born in us once again, that we may be continually born anew, that we may be born anew in this world, that the whole world would be reshaped and reborn as your kingdom emerges around us and within us. May your spirit of love stir within us and cause us to long for the day of Christ's coming, when heaven and earth collide with the glory and the fear of both angels and shepherds. It is this radical vision of a new heaven and a new earth for which we pray, using the words Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Sons and Thank you, Gail Harrell. Thank you, Rich Eberlin. Here's some words from Scripture. 1 Thessalonians says, don't suppress the Spirit. Don't brush off Spirit-inspired messages. And here's how I go about that during this time of year. I hardly ever carry cash with me anymore. I keep my phone with my phone in the case. I've got my driver's license and my debit card. It gets me through most situations. But this time of year, I make sure that I carry cash. The reason? There are these opportunities that come my way, and yours too, to give, to share, to put a 10 in the kettle, a 20 toward this cause. I don't want to miss those opportunities. There's a feeling somehow at this time of year when I'm more aware of my blessings, I want to respond. There's a feeling that comes to us, and we do well to go with it. That's what I think Paul is saying in that scripture text. When you feel the Spirit, go with it. When you feel that God is leading you to do something good, don't fight it. Go with it. At this moment, and in the days ahead, and the month that is ahead, we'll have lots of opportunities to do so. I hope that in this moment and in others, we'll go with it. Ushers, would you please come forward? Let's pray together. Lord, thank you for every moment of love and caring and inspiration and compassion that you give us. Forgive us for all those times when we have been busy with other things and ignored the momentary opportunity that was before us. Forgive us for those times when we felt those things, when you spoke to us and we talked ourselves out of it. But thank you for this moment. And for all of those moments when we have an opportunity to go with and to cooperate with your Spirit in us, through us, among us. Bless this time of doing so. Through Christ our Savior. Amen.
Change the world, gonna change the world. There's a little bitty baby.
Today's reading comes to us from the Hebrews scriptures in the book of Isaiah, chapter 40, verses 1 through 11. Comfort, O comfort my people, says your God. Speak tenderly to Jerusalem and cry out, cry to her that she has served her term, that her penalty is paid, that she has received from the Lord's hand double for all her sins.
A voice cries out in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make straight in the desert highway for our God. Every valley shall be lifted up, and every mountain and hill be made low. The uneven ground shall become level, and rough places a plain. The glory of the Lord shall be revealed, and all people shall see it together, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken.
A voice says, cry out. And I said, what shall I cry? All people are grass. Their consistency is like a flower of the field. The grass withers, the flower fades, when the breath of the Lord blows upon it. Surely the people are grass. The grass withers, the flower fades, but the word of our God will stand forever. Get up to a high mountain, O Zion, herald of good tidings. Lift up your voice with strength, Jerusalem, herald of good tidings. Lift it up, do not fear, say it to the cities of Judah. Here's your God.
See the Lord God comes with might, and his arm rules for him. He is rewarded with, is with him, and his recompense before him. He will feed his flock like a shepherd. He will gather the lambs in his arms and carry them in his bosom and gently lead the mother sheep. May God bless the reading, hearing, and understanding of these words. Thanks be to God. Please be seated.
We're going to learn a song together. This is a Puerto Rican tune, got sort of a calypso feel, has some syncopation to it. So let me go ahead and sing through it once for you. Linda, could I have a G major chord, please? Goes like this. Glory in the highest and peace on the earth. Glory in the highest and peace on the earth. Sing out the glad tidings of our Savior's birth. Sing out the glad tidings of our Savior's birth. Flame, do you know that well enough to sing that with me? Let's sing that together. 2, 3, 4, sing. Glory in the highest and peace on the earth. I don't know who gave them percussion, but I see that they brought some percussion instruments with them. So we're going to add a little percussion, all right? From the beginning, 2, 3, 4. Sing with me now and go.
Glory in the highest and peace on the earth. Glory in the highest and peace on the earth. Sing out the glad tidings of our Savior's birth. birth. Sing out the glad tidings of our Savior's birth.
Sing together, Jesus seeks. Jesus seeks no lodging that sets him apart. Jesus seeks no lodging that sets him apart. He looks for a dwelling, a home in your heart. He looks for a dwelling, a home in your heart.
What a great job. Thank you, Flame Worship Arts leaders. Every time they're up here, I just wonder. I'm not meaning to put any pressure, but I always wonder. I wonder if God might call one of them to be a preacher. I wonder if God has something special in terms of their continued leadership in the church. My mom died back in 2014. I was named executor of her will and estate, which meant that my wife Georgia and I spent a lot of time going through documents and boxes and so much stuff. Along with my siblings, we spent days and days, even weeks, cleaning out some 60 years of accumulated stuff in her house. Among the things we explored were some old family photos. I had seen the photographs, the old Polaroids and other Kodak prints from when I was young, and some from when my older siblings were born, and I was not yet born. But I found some photos of my mom from before that I'd never seen before. When she was a child, when she was a young woman, high school, when she was a mom who wasn't yet, when she was a wife who was not yet a mom. And as I was looking through these, I realized something for the first time. My mom was actually a very pretty woman. She was quite attractive. Strangely, I never saw her that way. She was just mom, the woman who cooked and cleaned and caught me doing a lot of things I wasn't supposed to be doing, always so hard at work around the house and on the farm. She was also the woman from whom I hid a lot of things, who I didn't want to know certain things about me and what I was like and how I conducted myself at school and away from home, especially as I did more of those things. Now, fortunately, I learned to see and notice those qualities of her as I matured. I expressed my appreciation about those things as I grew older. We had a really good relationship when she died. But for a long time there, I'm not sure I saw her as she really was. For generations, the people of Israel saw God in the same sort of way. Some priests and prophets did. Thank God they responded to what the Spirit told them. Thank God they wrote down what they sensed about the true nature of God. And we have many of their writings in the pages of the Hebrew Scriptures, but so many others. In fact, the majority of others only saw God as stern, always on their case. And when anything bad happened, birth defect, drought, flood, famine, disease, premature death, They viewed it as a result of that mean old God having caught them doing the things that they weren't supposed to. What I'm about to say to you is something I believe is very important. I invite you to please consider it. You will sometimes hear people say that when Jesus came, he was able to change God. That what God still feels about us is mostly disappointment and disgust and regret, disapproval because of our sin. But that Jesus was able to get God to kill him instead of killing all of us, which is really what God wants to do. I do not believe that. I do not believe, as some will say, and many preach, that God somehow changed between the time of the Hebrew Scriptures and the Christian Scriptures. What I do believe is that because of Jesus, we have come to a new understanding of God. What Jesus came to show us, teach us, and tell us about is the way that God has always been. Someone and something that is more beautiful, welcoming, and inclusive, and compassionate, and caring than people believed and most perceived. Jesus gave us a clearer picture of how God has always been. The lectionary reading that the Flame Arts kids read to us earlier from the writings of the prophet Isaiah are among those readings that our mothers and fathers in the faith tell us are the right ones to read on this second Sunday of the season of Advent. Those of you who were here or who tuned in online will perhaps remember that last week we also read from Isaiah. He has lots of prophecies about this thing God was going to do. The ones we heard last week said, "Come, let us go up to the Lord's mountain so that he may teach us his ways and so that we may walk in God's paths." We believe that in Jesus we've been invited to come close to God as God really is, so that we might see and learn. In Jesus, we see that God's path is forgiveness, not hatred. God's ways are inclusion, not exclusion and rejection. God's ways are mercy, not retribution. Now, I'm not here to re-preach last Sunday's sermon, but after I preach a sermon, I kind of go over it in my mind and think, how could I done better? What did I miss? That sort of thing. On Saturday nights, I'm always thinking about the following morning's sermon. And last evening, as I lay down to bed, I thought about that invitation. Come, let us go up to the Lord's mountain so that he may teach us his ways and so that we may walk in God's paths. In my experience, when people come close to God by reading Scripture, by worshiping together, by listening to sermons, by having a daily devotion time, there are many times when they do not come to learn. They gather to evaluate. They gather to either approve or disapprove what the preacher is saying. Yes, I know he or she has these decades of learning and teaching and training, but I don't know if I want to believe what he or she is telling me. We so often listen for confirmation of what we already believe, but learning from God, being willing to change, is something different. Those familiar with George Friedrich Handel's Messiah, that marvelous orchestral piece, will know that it begins with a dramatic overture, the strong, firm sounds of an opening string ensemble. And then, after the overture, the first vocal piece. And it begins with those words that we heard earlier. Comfort ye. Comfort ye, my people. God said to Isaiah, tell the people I'm not going to punish them. They've suffered enough. What I'm going to do is care for them like a shepherd cares for his sheep. Isaiah said this revelation of God's self, as God really is, will change things. It would change history and culture and individuals. But perhaps best of all, it has the potential to change our understanding of who God is, what God seeks to do, improve our understanding of what it is God seeks to do through us, how God seeks to be in relationship with us. The text gives a metaphor for just how dramatic this change would be. In order to understand, we do well to put it into historical context. These long ago people, of course, built things. But in order to build something, whether a house or a barn or anything else, you first had to level the land. They had to do this without the aid of large earth-moving equipment the way that we do today. It was hard work. It took a long time. They built fences, but first you had to get rid of the rocks. There was a lot of labor involved. They traveled roads, but in order to have a decent road, first you had to sort of level it. Whether it was going uphill or downhill, you sort of had to level it. And if that road came to a low place or a high place, there was no shaving off the mountain. There was no taking dump trucks full of rock to fill in the low place. You just had to go up or down or around. Earlier this year, a group of us from the church went to visit the Holy Land and visit Israel. It's sad for me to think that we do not know when that will once again be possible. But we went earlier this spring, and we traveled on modern highways, of course. Israel is a very modern, sophisticated nation in most places. But alongside of the roads, the tour guides will point out, look over there, there's a Bedouin trail. And what you see are these trails that have been used for hundreds, if not thousands, of years by shepherds and their sheep, by goats, by the shepherds themselves. And what you notice is they are so crooked. The reason is that it's hard work to make a road. If there's a high place, you just went around it. If there's a low place, you just went around it or you went down in it. So Isaiah, trying to convey how great this change would be, uses these words. Every valley shall be lifted up, and every mountain and hill made low. The uneven ground shall become level, and the rough places a plain. Then the glory of the Lord shall be revealed, and all people shall see it together, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken. He will feed his flock like a shepherd. He will gather the lambs in his arms and carry them in his bosom. If we understand these words, if we can catch a glimpse of how mighty this change is, we understand that we're talking about something radical, earth-shaking, life-changing, history-changing. It did, and it does. In Jesus, we see that God is not trying to punish us, trip us up. God is trying to teach us and save us from pain. In asking us and inviting us to live how Jesus taught, God is showing us the way to true happiness, to a smoother life, to contentment and purpose and meaning. God is trying to release us from the job of pointing out everyone else's flaws. God is inviting us to deal with the flaws and shortcomings of the one person over whom we have some control, ourselves. I've got to confess to you that Sometimes I think I don't have very much to say at all. Now, the scripture and the changing condition in the world give me a lot of material to work with, and I'll keep trying to be interesting for as long as I am able as your pastor, teacher, and preacher. But the truth of the matter is that I don't have all that much to say. As I think through my theology, I keep coming back to these simple, major themes, and this is one of them. What the world needs more than anything else is to get a clearer and better picture of God as God really is. The wonder of Jesus and the reason we rejoice and celebrate this season is not because Jesus got some sort of protective order so that God wouldn't hate us anymore, but because Jesus shows us the way God has always been and always will be. And God is love. God is patience and forgiveness. God is mercy and reconciliation. And when we see and realize that, things do change. The world changes within us, and the world changes around us. It's as if the walls and the mountains have been leveled, the valleys and pits raised up. These crazy, circuitous, theological routes that we have been created, that we've developed about trying to get God to love us through our actions and achievements, are straightened out and made into a simple, easy route of trust and faith. Let me say that I know this is challenging to many of us, not because we don't want it to be true, we do, but because of what we've heard preached, maybe especially here in the Bible Belt. People will say, hey, wait a minute, what about sin? God's got to demand some sort of payment for sin. What about those parts of the Bible that say God did punish the people for their sin? Here's my response. I would say that there is truth in that, but that it has been misinterpreted. Sin does bring pain and problems. In a way, sin brings its own punishment. See what happens in a society when people live as if there isn't a God. When politicians and leaders and governments lie as a matter of course, and it's expected. Try even having a society where people steal and lie and lust after their neighbor's belongings and will cheat and lie and steal and kill to get it. So yes, people suffer because of sin, but it's not because God is up in heaven directing bad things to happen. Here's my best metaphor for what I'm trying to describe. Ask any parent, and there are many of us, ask any parent who has had to suffer through watching their child suffer the consequences of his or her rebellion, whether financial, marital, relational, legal, or becoming snared in the addictions that sometimes entrap those children. The parents did not send those consequences. They agonize over the pain the child is going through. And so often the child realizes, sometimes too late, wow, I should have listened to mom and dad. Wow, my friends were trying to help me. Wow, my spouse, who I thought was always on my case, was actually trying to offer me something good. Wow. Hating and lying and cheating and looking out for only myself and judging others really isn't that great after all. Those parts of the Bible that talk about how God is going to destroy everything, that God hates this kind of person or that kind of person, that God delights when we kill the children of our enemies. That's in Scripture, by the way. Yes, those things are in Scripture, but I see them as a testimony to the way that people, even people of faith, what am I saying? Even people like you and me, even like those Christian brothers and sisters who are part of other communities of faith, that even people of faith so often do not see how God really is. Those verses were written out of fear, superstition. They were written because we hope God hates whoever we hate. But that's not an accurate picture. And anytime we come to that kind of teaching or preaching, here's the question to ask. How does that measure up against who Jesus is? And given those two alternatives, which one am I going with? It's so interesting that some people, when faced with that alternative, will turn away from Jesus and latch on to the other teaching about hate and judgment and resentment. This passage talks about the glory of the Lord. What is the glory of the Lord? Is it God coming in power to kill and destroy? That's the way some people think of it. Make our nation great. Ruin all the others. Help our tribe to conquer. Make the others suffer defeat. Or is the glory of the Lord God's constant, steadfast, persistent love? That, by the way, is the power of the cross. The most powerful empire of its time did the very worst thing you can do to a person when they crucified Jesus. They did the worst thing that can be done to God's word. They sought to silence it. But not even that killed God's love. Not even that caused God to turn on humanity. Not even that killed God's ability to touch people through Jesus Christ. The glory of the Lord shall be revealed. We believe that has happened in Jesus. But will it be seen? Will it be accepted? Will it be believed? Marion Bond West tells a story from her own life. She said, "For years, my ophthalmologist told me that I was too old to wear contact lenses. Well, eventually, me and my family moved to another city, and we had to sort of start again with grocery stores and doctors and churches and all the things that we had to find our place into. I needed a new eye doctor. Someone recommended one. I went. And on the first visit, I just happened to mention to this amazingly young man, my old doctor said, 'I'm too old for contacts.' The new doctor said, 'I don't think you are. Let's try them.' And then she says, in a few moments, a whole new world opened up for me as his assistant placed soft contacts in my eyes. I got up from the chair. He didn't ask me to. I got up from the chair. I went to the window. I looked down into the parking lot. I could see my car. I could almost read the license plate. I walked around the perimeter of the room, reading his certification and degrees and accreditation. I could read the words without squinting. I almost danced," she said, "as I left his office wearing my new contacts, my old glasses in my purse. All the way home, I smiled. I found myself pausing at every intersection just to look at the name on the street sign and realizing I can read that. I was nearly laughing out loud as I prayed, 'How marvelous to see clearly, Lord. And how marvelous it is when we see who and how God really is. The world changes. That's why we rejoice this holy season, because in Jesus, God has helped us see. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Thank you, Dr. Tully. Thank you to the Flame Worship Arts and to all those parents and grandparents and guardians who helped get them here for all those rehearsals so we could make it happen. You might have a chance to see them next Sunday evening, I think, some of them, 6 p.m. Yep. Our hymn of invitation is number 206 in your hymnals, I Want to Walk as a Child of the Light. Let's stand and sing together. What is our mission? To make disciples of Jesus Christ for the transformation of the world.
Thank you so much for being a part of this worship service. Thanks to our Flame Worship Arts leaders. We're very proud of you and grateful to you. And to Amelia as well, who is their constant and ever-present leader. Thank you so much. Couple of announcements that I want to share briefly. The first is thank you to all of you who have responded to the Waxahachie Care Angel Tree, which is just out in the narthex. There are still some angels left, but so many of you are bringing the gifts and the goods and the sleeping bags and the coats and hats that are needed for those who we get to serve in Christ's name. The deadline for returning those is next Sunday. Please keep that in mind. Next, I want to remind you that we've got several exciting opportunities of which we hope you will be a part, including next Sunday's worship. It's our big music Sunday when we'll do it up as big as we can with the orchestra and vocalists. It's a combined service, and anyway, it promises to be wonderful. This is a good one. If folks are looking for traditional worship, well done, with great music, this is the one to invite your family and friends to. I think that's about all I have to share with you, except once again to thank you. Let's receive this benediction. May God open our eyes through Jesus Christ to see and receive and learn who God really is, that we might be filled with His Spirit and share that good news and His love with all we encounter. Go in peace and go in joy. Amen.
Jesus seeks no lodging that sets Him apart. Jesus seeks no lodging that sets Him apart.